Okay, here is the second video lecture for Personality of Psychology, Marshall University, spring of 2018. I had just introduced the idea that it's important to take into consideration how groups impact us, how they impact our functioning, our mental health, our physical well-being, our personality development, etc., etc. And I can think of several examples of mental health disorders even that can be diagnosed simply because of group pressures. Roughly 10 to 12% of all people in this country suffer from what's called social phobia. A phobia, by definition, is an intense and irrational fear. Some people are afraid of needles, irrationally. Some people are afraid of spiders, heights. Well, we could go on and on. And I would wager a bet that in this class of about 24, probably there's 3 or 4 of you who are morbidly afraid, terrified to get up in front of people and speak. I used to be one of those as well. And often there are a lot of reasons. If you can trace back far enough, sometimes you can find reasons why people are afraid to do something, or why they may have mental health problems or even personality issues. If something awful happens while you're giving a speech as a child, that traumatic experience can follow that child into adulthood. There are some people who are so afraid to leave their homes because they're afraid that something embarrassing will happen. I had a client who didn't leave her house for a decade because a long time ago she had a panic attack in public. I think it was actually the town center mall, if I'm being precise. She had an anxiety attack and she lost consciousness. And she ended up having an embarrassing accident, if you follow my drift. And when she came to, someone was helping her to her car in the parking garage. She realized she had had an accident. And the thoughts started to go through her mind, you know, oh my gosh, who saw this? You know, it's hard to tell who saw this. Did they make fun of me? Are they going to judge me for it? And she was so afraid to leave her house because she was afraid this would happen again. Group pressures. The idea of being around groups of people or having groups of people judge her steered her into this mental health disorder called agoraphobia. And she had some personality problems that accompanied as well this disorder. Natural disasters, things in the physical environment or the natural world, not just the social environment, can also contribute to personality development or mental health problems. People who lose their homes to fires or floods can certainly develop depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, even personality disorders. Now we segue into the next thing that I want to talk about. We're moving away from the three levels of analysis that we'll revisit throughout this course, and we're moving into the three grand issues of psychology. There are three major issues in psychology that we come back to over and over again, and this class will be no different. The first one is stability versus change. I know that's kind of dark. I don't know if you can see that. I'm trying to adjust my camera. At the top of that, it says stability. Well, you can see it better at the bottom. Stability versus change. We're asking the question, to what extent do things stay the same, and to what extent do things change? If we were in class, I would ask you to tell me some things that you think of that that never change, that remain the same. It's hard to do that. Some of the answers you may come up with is your biological sex, being male or female. Well, okay, that's true. We could even argue that a little bit. I have a couple of close friends who have actually had surgeries to change their biological sex. So even that is something that can change. Your social security number probably is not going to change. Again, hard to think. Your birth date is not going to change. What about your personality? Does your personality change? Most research suggests that by the age of, depending on what research you're looking at, between the ages of 5, 6, and 7, somewhere in there, your basic personality is pretty much set. That's not to say that it can't change, but basically there's not, most people don't change their personalities a whole lot, especially once you get into adulthood. Now we can argue that, and there are some theories that suggest that this isn't necessarily true. Now, it's easier to think of things that can change. Even someone who is depressed, like for example, with depression. Someone who has clinical depression is not always depressed. On average, if someone has clinical depression, they'll experience approximately 5 more episodes of clinical depression. They may go 2 or 3, 4, 5, 10 years between episodes of depression. So most things can change. Even some facets of personality can change. The next major issue or grand issue that we talk about is the big one: nature versus nurture, or heredity versus environment, whichever one you want to call that. Are we born with what makes us what we are? In other words, our personalities. And we went through this in class a little bit with the exercise where I ask you to write down 20 things that you think describe you and your personality. Are you born being outgoing, partying, happy, athletic, nerdy, introverted, quiet, dorky, clumsy, whatever that list is? If you can think about that list that you wrote down about yourself, are you born that way, or are you taught to be that way? Is it the environment that you're placed in that brings this stuff out of you? John Watson, a famous behaviorist, once said that he could essentially take any child and place him or her after birth and place him or her in any environment and make him or her turn out however he wanted them to, just based on manipulation of the physical and social environment. Or maybe is it both? Are we born with genetic predispositions for certain things? And is it also the environment, physical and natural environments or the social and the natural environments also that shape our personality development? Is it a combination of nature and nurture? Probably it is. And to what extent, we can argue from here on. Of course, one of the biggest arguments and debates that we get into in all the social sciences revolves around sexual orientation. I have friends who are gay and bisexual, and I've had discussions with my friends about this a lot. And what they seem to tell me, some will tell me that they knew from birth that they were attracted to the same sex or both sexes. Others have told me that they learned to be this way, that they were essentially placed in certain environments that sort of led them to feel a sexual attraction to the same sex, or to both sexes. So the research is complicated on this. So again, we talk about personality. I mean, certainly when you talk about sexual orientation, that's a big part of who we are as human beings. It revolves around our attraction to other people. How does this also impact our personalities, or what does it say about our personality development? Or is there even a relationship at all? Certainly, I think there is, and that's something that we can talk about. Even people we consider to be physically, not necessarily sexually attractive, but just physically attractive. Is this something that is genetically endowed upon us? If you go back to the Middle Ages, the idea of the epitome, if you will, of sexual attractiveness for a female wasn't someone who was thin. It was someone who was essentially obese by our standards today. And you might say, why? Well, I mean, historically, if you take history into account, back during the Middle Ages, if you were overweight, this was a sign of wealth because you had money to eat. You could afford to buy food, and that was kind of a big deal. So it was a status thing. It was a sign of status and wealth, and people were also attracted to that. So have we always attributed wealth and sexuality? Did we still do that? Maybe. So does society? Does the media kind of set forth these standards of what is physically and sexually attractive for us to consume? And is that genetic or is that environment? Well, yeah, it's probably a little bit of both. We have rationality versus irrationality. This is the last of the three major issues, and then we'll stop this video here in a minute, that we're going to deal with in any psychology class. We all have the propensity to act rationally and irrationally. Irrationally, by definition, means void of reason. We all do things that don't make any sense. There's no reason to do it. If we were in a class, I would ask you by show of hands, how many of you have ever punched a locker, destroyed a cell phone out of anger, punched another person? I think I actually did ask you guys this. These are all, by definition, irrational behaviors. It makes no sense to do this because there's no possible positive outcome that can come from these things. But we all do these things. Now, does this mean that you have a mental health disorder or a personality flaw or a personality disorder because you act irrationally from time to time? Not necessarily, no. Could it mean that you have a mental health problem or a personality disorder? Or Perhaps. Does it say something more generally about your personality development or your personality? Perhaps. So we go back and forth with that. I know this looks really appetizing. If I had your favorite chocolate candy, and I ask you if you wanted to eat your favorite chocolate candy right now at the end of this class, if we were in class, a lot of you would say, yeah, sure. And then I would present it to you in this. This is not really poop. It's really the candy that you so crave and desire. My next question would be, how many of you would now not eat this, would now not eat this candy? And some of you would raise your hands. And my question would be, well, why not? You know it's not really poop. It's really the chocolate that you like. So it would be an irrational decision to decide now that you do not want to eat this just because it looks like poop. So does this mean that you have a personality problem? No, not necessarily. Just sometimes we can't get past the perception of something. So we're going to go ahead and call this the end of the second video lecture here. Thanks.